Resident Evil 3 Nemesis is one of those titles that has far better concepts than their actual implementation. Your opinion of the game is going to depend entirely on how much you appreciate its ideas and what issues you're willing to accept, forgive, or just look past. And while there are a bunch of games that I absolutely adore in spite of their problems, Resident Evil 3, sadly, is not among them. You don't even need to dig into the history of the game's development to understand why it might not have been properly fleshed out. It was released in 1999, just a year after Resident Evil 2, with no parallel development alongside it. And actually digging a bit deeper will reveal that Nemesis didn't even have a full year of production. So it's no surprise that Resident Evil 3 is quite frankly an undercooked game, considering that the final product is targeting some lofty ambitions. And for what it's worth, Nemesis is a more interesting step in the evolution of the franchise than its predecessor was. While on one hand, Resident Evil 3 tries to push itself even further into action territory, to the point that it can fall apart mechanically, it actually tries to bring back real survival horror sensibilities, not just flavor. Though that comes with caveats. With Resident Evil 3 being another series iteration on the same gameplay engine, there's no sense in having a long prelude. Even the porting situation this time around is much more straightforward. Versions on PS1, PC, Dreamcast and GameCube are pretty much the same game, where the only notable differences are the available selection of bonus outfits, what's the pre-rendered background resolution, and the ability to skip cutscenes. So let's jump into Resident Evil 3 and see how it attempts to innovate, but regrettably stumbles, starting with the setting itself, Raccoon City. Even in the more guided paradigm of Resident Evil 2, the games have always been good at creating tight, interconnected spaces. And the beginning uptown segment of Resident Evil 3, with some of its closed loops and shortcut unlocks, makes it feel like it is a tutorial introduction to a very intricate city environment. But it's not. In fact, for the most part, Raccoon City is a single, straight line with protruding standalone parts to various buildings and no interconnectivity at all, even though a city setting is perfect for this. As it stands though, even the far less complex than the Mansion Police Station is more intricate than Raccoon City, which only has an illusion of being big and complex by putting its screens on a windy path and having a lot of tight, long streets. Which wouldn't have been a problem had Resident Evil 3 been a linear title. But it's not, and here we get to the first caveat brought by the game trying to actually bring back survival horror sensibilities without the possibility to fully flesh them out. Not only does it have the by now traditional for the series goal of collect X objects before you can progress to the next main area, it also introduces things like switching item locations and playing different cutscenes depending on which buildings you visit first. We'll discuss that last aspect a bit more later, but on a high level, it's only an illusion to distract you from the fact that what you're gonna be doing is just moving back and forth on the same street several times to gather everything up. The structure of Resident Evil 3 is ironically afraid to embrace the linearity of its map design, which consistently leads to various design issues in pretty much every area. The clock tower was clearly meant to evoke the atmosphere of the mansion from Resident Evil 1, and visually it does, but it's just two entry points and two pathways. And the only way to progress is to go all the way up the clock tower, solve an annoying puzzle, go all the way down and open the pathway towards an even more excruciatingly annoying puzzle, and then go all the way back up to the top of the clock tower again. The game tries to make it seem like the area is more open than it actually is. But at least the clock tower blocks one of its paths early enough, unlike the park, where you won't be able to achieve anything should you go to the left, since you actually have to trek to the right side as far as possible to get a key which will unlock a door on the left side, and after a boring boss battle with a giant worm, you'd go all the way back to the right again. Resident Evil 3 also revisits the police station from Resident Evil 2, but access to most of it is blocked. And what do you know, outside of a small side pathway, the available rooms once again form a straight line. Now, while there is just tons of it here, you know I'm not against linear backtracking in principle, as long as the game keeps changing context and providing variety to just make sure you're not doing the same thing over and over again. There are several ways Resident Evil 3 attempts to handle that. The most important is, of course, the namesake of the game, Nemesis. I absolutely adore Nemesis. Conceptually. A fearsome enemy who keeps hunting you throughout the whole duration of the game, and you can't kill him but only disable for a while after spending a lot of resources and managing to avoid actually dying, so you always have to weigh the potential risks? Yes, please! That's definitely a direction that is perfect for survival horror, and he really does make one hell of a first impression.
Jill!
Brad!
We've gotta...
Whenever you decide to fight him for the first time, you'll quickly realize he's got just a massive amount of health. And should you run away, hearing him close the door as he follows you to the same screen is surprising, given how in previous games enemies could do this only if specifically scripted, and that didn't happen a lot in the first place. The ambient music when he's around is very tense, while the tune whenever he barges in somewhere deliberately starts with very startling notes. And of course, we can't ignore neither the visual design nor him constantly saying "stars" as he's out to take out the last remaining in Raccoon City member of that squad, our protagonist Jill Valentine, returning from the first game. All this creates a particularly menacing facade. But that's what it ultimately is, a facade. The idea of Nemesis is scarier than the actual Nemesis. Partially, this is due to the extremely linear design of the game's environments. Here's the one thing you have to do to escape Nemesis. Run forward. There are times when he stands on the path to the door you need to reach, but even in those situations, you just run past him, and in case you take a hit, that's usually not a big deal anyway. The Nemesis is fast, but he can't enter a location where the door to it is visible since, you know, it's pre-render, so there can be no animation. This means that you always have a head start. Sometimes he doesn't even have enough time to enter the room and you're gone. Other times he does manage to catch up, but as long as you just keep running, there's no way that he can hit you. And should he reach you when you get to a door, well, you're about to change screens anyway. One other thing that you quickly learn is that the moments when Nemesis starts hunting you are not actually random. They're all scripted, which is absolutely fine every now and then, but Nemesis will never appear just because. It's always either after visiting a building or backtracking after getting a key item. While somewhat predictable, they still would have been fine if internally, after appearing, his movement across rooms was actually dynamic, as in the game would keep track of which section of the map he was in and then change it behind the scenes, creating the illusion of him searching for you. However, Nemesis just seems to throw a dice roll and decide if he follows you towards a particular spot, chosen as one where he will appear 100% if not defeated previously, or whether he's going to be there from the get-go. You can't play cat and mouse with him. Should you make him follow through an abysmally small amount of potential loops to lose track, he's just going to teleport to the scripted waiting point anyway. Things aren't that much better if you decide to stand your ground and fight Nemesis. The past Resident Evil games don't have great action mechanics. Even Resident Evil 2, which has basically increased the pace tenfold in comparison to its predecessor, understood that boss battles are better kept brief and simple. Which incidentally includes the Tyrant following you in B scenarios, a proto-Nemesis, so to speak. Resident Evil 3, in the name of making Nemesis, Nemesis, goes against that very important principle. You will eat tons of bullets, even from a magnum or a grenade launcher loaded with freeze rounds to which he's weak against. And that just makes him a boring enemy to fight. Mind you, he's not easy. He's pretty much the most dangerous monster of the Resident Evil series has seen up to this point. The Nemesis can dodge bullets. He has a powerful running attack to close the distance between you two. He can grab you and then throw you down, and if you don't mash the buttons fast enough to get up, he might just grab you for a second time in a row. And sometimes he gets into battle with a rocket launcher. So he definitely has a pretty extensive moveset for a Resident Evil game. The problem is, you don't. The only thing you can really do is shoot, reposition, and shoot. To be fair, Resident Evil 3 does add a quick turn feature allowing you to instantly rotate 180 degrees, and that's very helpful and does make the overall gameplay feel smoother across the board. There's also a new dodge mechanic to balance out the speed and tenacity of your nemesis. Now that one's not great. First, dodge works only when you activate it during an enemy's attack animation, meaning after their windup has ended, but before they collide with you. Here's the problem. A lot of enemies in the game, like zombies, barely have any windups, and their attack animations are of the blink and you'll miss it variety. Ironically, because of that, it's much harder to learn how to dodge against zombies than it is against Nemesis, who has very noticeable windups. Then, the dodge doesn't provide any invincibility frames, meaning that you can successfully dodge and still get slapped due to Jill not moving enough in the very tight small spaces of Resident Evil 3. If that wasn't annoying enough, to dodge you have to press either the aim or shoot action, meaning that you can sometimes dodge when you don't want to. So instead of shooting and potentially killing or staggering an enemy, you might put yourself into a worse position. Still, even with all these issues, dodging is incredibly effective against the Nemesis, which makes him even more boring than he was. Again, I want to specifically separate engagement from difficulty. Does dodging Nemesis consistently require skill? Yes, and some luck due to even this guy's animations being inconsistent in length. Does this make him a more interesting opponent to fight against? No! You still have to do the same thing over and over. Shoot, reposition, shoot. Only now repositioning sometimes takes the form of dodging by trying to aim or shoot at appropriately timed moments. The mechanical depth and engagement is just not there relative to how time-consuming these battles are. Should you decide to fight and defeat the Nemesis outside of a mandatory battle, you'll get a special item. Stuff like a set of 3-8 kits or weapon parts that can later be combined into really useful gear. Now, at first glance, this seems like a great risk-reward concept, because it is. But like so many other things in Resident Evil 3, it is undermined by the game itself. Resident Evil 3 introduces bullet crafting, which is an amazing feature that's set up in a way fitting for survival horror. You have different types of gunpowder, A, B, and C. A and B can be found in the world, while gunpowder C can only be received by combining A and B together. You can also combine a single gunpowder type with itself to make a bigger stack, like AA or AAA. If you combine gunpowder with the reloading tool, you will create bullets. Handgun ones from type A, shotgun shells from type B, grenade rounds from type C, magnum rounds from triple C, the AC, BC, double C combinations will create, let's call them, elemental types of grenade rounds, which you can also make by combining gunpowder with standard grenade rounds directly. There is other aspects to bullet crafting, like the more bullets you craft, the better at it you become, to the point that eventually you can make enhanced handgun and enhanced shotgun rounds. While some quality of life features are missing, for example you can't combine stacks of different ammo types together even if they have the same amount, there is such a wide array of choices that can potentially increase the complexity of your decision making on whether you wish to use gunpowder immediately or preserve it for later. There is even a greater potential for depth considering that the weapons you get from defeating Nemesis can't use enhanced ammo. Now, all this choice, it doesn't matter really. I mean, before you get too excited about weapons you can create by defeating Nemesis, while they are more powerful and useful than your default handgun and shotgun with normal bullets, they don't have any real advantages over your default weapons with enhanced bullets. For example, the new pistol has a chance to blow off a zombie's head like a magnum. It's a really good weapon, but I can't say that it has distinct strategic advantages over the increased strength and stagger that enhanced bullets cause, even on Nemesis. Once you realize that, you're gonna wonder, what's the point of fighting Nemesis in the first place when running away from him is simply trivial and more effective of a strategy? But Resident Evil 3 wants to make sure you have the possibility to take Nemesis down in every encounter, so it will provide enough bullets and gunpowder for that to happen. Which is already quite a lot, but here's another thing. The game also wants to make sure you have enough bullets to take down all other enemies encountered. Which is similar to the principles followed in previous games, sure, except now there is randomization of items and monsters across various screens, and Resident Evil 3 can't live knowing it might leave you underprepared for any of them. As a result, the only reason why you might not swim in ammo is if you decide to be very conservative with gunpowder, like I was during my first playthrough. But there's no reason to be. And the randomization is just such a crutch to make the constant backtracking bearable. The Resident Evil series is no stranger to repopulating areas to always keep you wondering what you might encounter. Lack of knowledge is what enhances the aspects of survival horror, and randomization could potentially work, if it's done right. To me, it's questionable whether going into a safe room in an empty street and then seeing a bunch of zombies immediately after getting out just a short while after can be considered done right. Three brain suckers appearing the first time you enter the room, then having a chance to appear again the other time you enter the room, then having another chance of spawning again is not intense. It's annoying because it's the same enemies over and over again, and it's not like you won't be overflown with ammo to deal with all of them every time. The placement of many items is also randomized, and with the map design of Resident Evil 3, this has the effect of messing up your item management rather than creating interesting choices, since really all that this does is if you happen to replay, you might not know if you'll have enough inventory slots to take everything once you enter a building or not. Since randomization is not just about whether you might find one item in a location or another, but also whether you can find 0 or 3 or 6. Not enough space for all of them? More boring backtracking it is. For placement randomization to work properly, a more in-depth system is required than just random chance. If anything, playing Resident Evil 3 makes it exceptionally clear why future games in the series would start to adopt dynamic difficulty principles, but that is not a discussion for this review. Puzzle solutions are also randomized. And it's weird because Resident Evil 3 is really hell-bent on making puzzles more in-depth than the previous games, where complexity of the puzzles wasn't their point in the first place. As a result, the pace just halts, especially considering that in most puzzles it's more straightforward to use a trial and error approach rather than figuring out what is the actual logic behind it. I'd say that's the case even for puzzles with easy to understand logic like the water treatment one, it's just that it's so out of place for Resident Evil 3's style of pacing that you just get annoyed more and more the longer it takes to make sure the amount of blocks across three lines gets aligned properly. And out of place is how I honestly can describe a lot of what Resident Evil 3 does. In the context of the core mechanics still taking roots from the first game, I honestly just don't understand what Nemesis is trying to actually do. Resident Evil 3 has an increased focus on action to the point that you can finally just freely walk on stairs without a separate button press as do the zombies. And boy are some zombies really fast here, but just increasing the amount of enemies and making them random is not what makes for an interesting action game. more purposeful pacing and contextual changes are responsible for that. Resident Evil 3 attempts to introduce tactical elements through stuff like exploding objects and whatnot, and one of your buttons actually allows you to aim specifically at those interactables. But also the environments are so narrow that you don't have to lure zombies anywhere, you just wait until they get closer. Resident Evil 3 has exceptionally linear environments while asking you to explore and go back and forth. It wants you to feel hunted by the nemesis and regularly decide whether you should take the fight or flight approach while making neither decisions compelling in terms of actual gameplay. It added dodge but didn't adapt previously existing enemies for comfortable use of the feature. It added crafting so you'd make resource management choices but then adds too many resources because it doesn't want randomization to put you in a spot you wouldn't be able to get out of. And say the randomization has no semblance of structure and therefore it doesn't really work from a pacing perspective. I guess, in some ways, all these features are supposed to tap into the pillar of player choice Resident Evil 3 tries to build. But even the most front-facing aspect of that also doesn't quite work. Like pretty much everything else in Resident Evil 3, the concept of player choice affecting narrative is wonderful, but the implementation is really undercooked. There are two types of choices the game focuses on, organic and direct. Let's focus on organic first, since it's prominent mostly in the first Raccoon City part of the game and less so later down the line. The idea is that events in the story will change depending on your actions, more specifically which places you decide to visit first. In practice, like most other things in Resident Evil 3, it's nothing more than an atmospheric facade. For example, you can meet your main ally Carlos either in the restaurant or the newspaper office. It should be noted that because of the linear street environments, it is highly unlikely a first-time player is going to visit the office before the restaurant, but putting that aside, the differences in the two events are… well, just some dialogue. That's it!
What's that?
Calm down, lady. I'm no zombie. My name's Carlos, Corporal of Umbrella's Biohazard Countermeasure Force. What's your name?
Jill, did you just say you belong to Umbrella's army?
Yeah, we came all the way out here to save you civilians. But the mission went bad the minute we landed.
Hey.
Where am I?
Relax, you're fine.
If you say so, but my head feels like it's about to explode. Anyway, name's Carlos. Glad to meet you, lady.
Jill, Alpha Team, RPD's STARS unit, who do you represent?
STARS, I see. Well, I'm a member of the Biohazard Countermeasure Force sent by Umbrella Incorporated.
Sent by Umbrella?
Hey, don't look at me like that. What did I say? Do you have a problem?
Everything else stays the same, including the fact that Nemesis is going to show up. Now, the reason why I'm calling this setup a facade is that the key item you need for opening the nearby gate is going to be in whatever building you visit second. So while the game positions this as things changing depending on your decision where to go first, in reality, it doesn't matter. Whatever you do, meeting Carlos will happen first, finding the gem second. The only thing that changes from your organic choices is the environment an event happens in, which incidentally makes the choice less meaningful than it would have been had the events been set precisely per building, because then, if we continue with this example, there'd be a possibility to get the key item before meeting Carlos, which could potentially change the entire chain of events you're doing. Another organic thing the game tries to do is activate some events in case you decide to backtrack somewhere, some of the times in very specific circumstances. For example, in the beginning, you will interact with one Dario Rosso who's refusing to leave his safe space in the warehouse. If you get back to the warehouse later down the line, you will discover that he did eventually decide to get out, only to meet his demise. This is a very nice detail, except since the environments are, once again, very linear, to get back to the warehouse you'll have to backtrack all the way to the beginning with no real reason to do so. Besides the organic choices, Resident Evil 3 tries to put a big focus on direct ones. At some moments, the game pauses and you need to select one of two possible actions to continue. They're a bit less meaningless than organic ones. Some of the choices close to the end actually have narrative repercussions related to the resident shithead of this game, Nikolai. There's a couple choices that change your entry point into a particular area, and some related to Nemesis that change the manner in which you'll fight him during the mandatory boss battle, or whether you want to get an item from him while risking a chase later, or just make sure he won't be seen anywhere nearby for the foreseeable future. Whenever you make a choice, you don't know what the outcome is going to be, which in the first playthrough does lead to a pretty intense dilemma. Do you climb up from a hole while boxes slide toward you, or jump down? However, after making a choice, you will learn the consequences, and considering that Resident Evil 3 wants to focus on replayability, you will also find out that it either doesn't really matter, or some choices are just strictly better than others. Returning to this climbing up example, that's the only correct choice, as not only does Jill climb up, but she also evades the boxes. If she jumps down, she'll have to make a small detour back to the same place, which, well, it's also irrelevant to be honest, but less desirable. I suppose all these decision points have been added for a seeming sake of depth. That this game's one replayable campaign with Jill is worth as much as multiple scenarios in previous titles, but I'm gonna be honest, I appreciate a shorter, tighter experience more than a game trying to be what it's not. But then again, what is Resident Evil 3 trying to be? I guess the game itself doesn't know. After beating it, you unlock the Mercenaries mode, this game's iteration on the battle mode and extreme battle from previous games. And in terms of the actual rule set, this is the most successful iteration of such a minigame. You have to reach the endpoint before the time runs out, while saving citizens on the way as well as killing enemies will provide time bonuses. And the higher your kill chain is, the bigger the bonus. Every run, you will acquire money, which you can use to get bonus items for Jill in the actual campaign. This is actually a very neat rule set, but it doesn't work within the confines of Resident Evil 1 mechanics the game is still using. Shooting isn't a particularly satisfying action, targeting is rudimentary, tactics during encounters barely exist. It is something that can be fun because the idea is great, not because it is actually implemented in a meaningful way, and I've mentioned the specificity of Resident Evil 3 so much that honestly I think it is time to rate it with a Stasocritic scoring system. Stasocritic is divided into 5 categories. Each has its own particular weight and a number of ratings from 0 to 10 with their specific criteria. The first category is design that has a weight of 4, since the way a game plays is what affects your experience the most. And here I will assign a 4. Resident Evil 3 is chock full of absolutely amazing ideas and concepts. But the way Resident Evil 3 handles its map layouts, enemy design, choice systems, crafting, pretty much everything else it does goes against one another. There's absolutely no synergy. But it's also a thing that's not as noticeable in your first playthrough, because Resident Evil 3 successfully creates an illusion of its concepts working entirely as expected. And in a game that is not really meant to be replayed, that's absolutely fine, and that kind of game I would score higher. But Resident Evil 3 focuses on replayability just as much as its predecessors. And that's when the illusion crumbles. You start to notice how your choices don't matter, how the feeling of resource conservation is just you not getting a full grasp of the gunpowder system, how Nemesis does basically the exact same things in the exact same order, and there's no reason to actually be tense regarding his appearance. The aforementioned illusion is largely responsible for how high the score is going to be in the emotions category that has a weight of 3. More specifically, I will assign a 6. The biggest irony is that based on my first Resident Evil 3 playthrough, I thought I'd assign an 8. And then I began my replays to not only try different things out, but also understand the extent of how Resident Evil 3 systems work. That might have been a mistake, one might say. Unlike Resident Evil 1 and 2, where replays actually brought in more appreciation for the titles, different in their goals as they are and how static their scenarios might be, replaying Resident Evil 3 literally ruined it for me. My second playthrough would warrant a score of 3, my third score of 2. I can't ignore the disappointment seeing Resident Evil 3's facade fall off, but also it would be inappropriate to fully discount the first impressions I've had from the title, so the score of 6 seems to be appropriate. Next, we have cohesion, a category with a weight of 2 that's all about how well all the different aspects of a game are connected to one another. Here I will also assign a 6. Again, the core direction is very strong. Escaping an infected city that's at the danger of being wiped out by a nuclear strike decreed by the government, while a huge chunk of something just keeps chasing you throughout, hellbent on eliminating you specifically, is a very compelling fantasy. But I've already lamented how all the elements surrounding that fantasy don't quite fit, so I don't really see a reason to repeat myself there. The discussion for the context category is going to be particularly interesting, I guess. It's all about the plot, narrative structure, character arcs, writing, and so on. And you might have noticed that I haven't touched upon this aspect at all throughout the video. It's not because it's bad or anything, in fact I will assign a 6. It's just that outside of the overall premise, there's nothing particularly interesting to discuss. Jill is more defined than in the first game, but she's not that interesting of a character still. Carlos, outside of some dumb jokes that assume Jill wants to build over him, is dull. The resident shithead Nikolai is a shithead, what more can I say? The core premise is strong, but writing doesn't reach the quality levels of Resident Evil 2, but also is not as ridiculous as that of Resident Evil 1.
Carlos, I don't believe it. You're alive!
I'm not sure how we're gonna get out of this town.
What are you talking about? We made it!
You don't get it. They have no intention of letting us make it back alive. Do you really think we can trust their great evacuation plan? Huh, it's just a piece of paper.
But we don't have any other choice than to trust them right now.
No, if we're gonna die, then we should get to choose when it happens.
So that's it then, huh? You're giving up?
No. I just... I can't handle it!
Something similar happens with the aesthetics category as well. I will assign an 8. Overall, the strengths are the same as in Resident Evil 2, particularly the music. Without a doubt, the soundtrack of Resident Evil 3 is extremely memorable and the save room theme has got to be one of my favorites. That being said, there are two significant stepbacks. The first is voice acting. It's not great.
Wait, I have to ask you something.
I know, you want to ask me out. All the foxy ladies love my accent. It drives them crazy.
Yeah, no, it's not great at all. Maybe not as meme-worthy as that of Resident Evil 1, but pretty far away from Resident Evil 2's vastly improved acting. And then there's the environment design, which somehow manages to be pretty dull overall. The city streets are just one big, unimpressive mush. Dead Factory is a boring dump. The saving grace is the character and enemy design, plus how well various visual effects make some screens look better. Which leads us to the final Stasocritic rating. Should we take all scores and their weights together, Resident Evil 3 Nemesis is going to get a Stasocritic score of 55. Now, there's one thing I need to make sure you understand about Stasocritic, particularly if this is your first time watching. This is not Metacritic. The whole range of scores is used, and most games out there are actually going to land somewhere between the score of 50 and 70-ish. As a whole, 55 means that the game is alright. As long as you know what to expect and are willing to either accept or look past the game's flaws, because the concept and emotions resulting from it are more important to you, you're going to have a very fine time. For everyone else, well, maybe this is not going to be the best choice. I I do not live in a cave. I know full well that Resident Evil 3 Nemesis is a title that's beloved by many, and I do expect the comment section to let me know that. I understand where this love comes from. After all, I've repeatedly mentioned how conceptually Resident Evil 3 has tons of very strong points. So the purpose of this video is neither to challenge that love nor try to prove anyone wrong. If Resident Evil 3 has a place in your heart, that's absolutely wonderful and it deserves to stay there. Sadly, it didn't get a place in mine, and I hope I've explained the arguments why clearly enough. However, I do think Resident Evil 3 is very fascinating from a perspective of the franchise's evolution. Resident Evil 1 was pure survival horror. Resident Evil 2 is a horror-themed action game that managed to be a really good one thanks to smartly staying within the mechanical confines of the previous game. Resident Evil 3 attempts to do what I'd call a survival thriller, an action-focused experience where survival elements are still very important. So for what it's worth, the pillars of Resident Evil 1 actually matter more for this game than the last one. In fact, it tries to incorporate all of them. But every other element clashes with one another. It's no wonder that a certain game that tried to make a survival thriller done right changed everything in terms of gameplay, but once again, that's beyond the focus of this review. I hope you have enjoyed this video, and I do look forward to discussing Resident Evil 3 Nemesis with you in the comment section. Thank you all for watching.
You want stars? I'll give you stars.